Have any of you ever gone to the Bible and just open it up and say, I don't know what I'm supposed to do with my life, so you just open it up and you point to a verse? Anybody ever done that? I have. It's not good thinking. Because there's the old joke about the person who opened it up and pointed to a verse and said, Judas hung himself. It's like, oh, that's not good. So he opened up and he pointed again and said, pointed a verse and said, go now and do likewise. So you got to be very careful about how we read the Bible. There was a question that was asked by to Bruce Metzger, and Bruce Metzger was so learned and involved and old when I was at Princeton. He had retired, but Metzger was asked the question, is the Bible meant to be taken literally? And Metzger's response was, the Bible is meant to be taken seriously. And so there's a question of, because some churches will talk about, well, we are a fundamentalist church, or we are this, or we're that. The Presbyterian Church, our Presbyterian Church, our denomination, the PCUSA, would not be described as being a fundamentalist church, which is to say that some folks will say the Bible says it, I believe it, and that settles it. The point is, what does the Bible really say? And we keep reading about what the Bible says, because you can read certain things in the Old Testament and then read something in the New Testament and say they don't quite match up, or they don't feel like they go hand in glove. And sometimes people will try to do backflips to make sure to connect all these dots. A good example is, open Genesis 1. So we read the story of creation in Genesis 1. And then, did you know there's two stories of creation? We all know it. You do know it. I guarantee it. Because the first creation story in Genesis 1 through Genesis 2:4 is day one, light and darkness, right? You know, then you get fish and fowl and humans and all that stuff. So that goes throughout all the days. And then there's a day 7, and it says, God looked at everything that he made, and he rested, and he said, it's holy. And then, Genesis 2:5, you begin the next creation story, which is Adam and Eve. You have two stories about creation right at the beginning of the Bible. You go to Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and they're very similar Gospels. The accounts are very similar, but they have very distinct differences. But those three are called the Synoptic Gospels. The fourth Gospel, John, is way different. And everything in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, Jesus is getting ready to go to Jerusalem. And in John, he's there in the second chapter. Second or third chapter, he's in there. So it's these questions when we're trying to say, we're trying to read the Bible, you know, we got to be very careful. We're not trying to read the Bible like a straight history book or a straight science book. We have to understand, and that's why a lot of people get really worked up and bent out of shape. I'm going to talk at the sermon a little bit about in Joplin on Third Thursdays, which was our downtown block party when we were there, and kind of everybody shows up. I mean, when I say everybody, I mean everybody, good, bad, and indifferent, right? And there's these guys with these huge beards, you know, and these overalls, and they're not Amish, because Amish are nice. And they got these sandwich boards, right? That they're always the same sandwich boards. In all 7 years, it's always the same sandwich board, but one always had the one that said, repent for the, take a guess, the end is near. And because you read, if you read the book of Revelation like you read the Psalms, you wouldn't do that. You wouldn't read the book of Revelation the way you read the gospel. Revelation is called apocalyptic literature. And that is, there's only a handful of books in the Bible that are apocalyptic. There's Revelation, there's Daniel, there's a short one in Matthew. There's some bits and pieces you'll get in the Old Testament. But apocalyptic literature was not meant to be read literally. It never was. But yet, how many of you have ever heard the book, The Late Great Planet Earth? Hal Lindsey, anybody remember that? And that was like a big thing, I think, in the 70s maybe. But then how many of you ever heard of the books Left Behind? You know, sold millions and millions of copies. And it's based off what I would say is a faulty reading of Revelation, a faulty understanding of what's called dispensationalism, which is switching the whole of Christian history into like these different epochs, these different time periods, and we're always living in the end times. Nobody ever says we're living into the next end times, right? They say Jesus is coming back next week. And so that's the whole point of what Revelation is about apocalyptic literature is to remind everybody, the reader, that God's got this, that God's in charge, that the God who created in Genesis has already won the battle. It's like the battle's not happened yet, but it's already been won. It was won on the cross. And so when we read the book of Revelation as 21st century people living in the West, it's very dangerous for us to do that and say this is what it means. Because imagine ourselves to be a first or second century Christian who's being persecuted, who is has the possibility of going to be burned alive or be sent to the Colosseum to be eaten by lions. Like, the book of Revelation was meant to be a comfort, not to scare children. And yet our view of things is far more Dante's Inferno with that. What are we talking about? The Good Book is actually a collection of good books from many different writers. The Old Testament was the covenant of law. The New Testament, the covenant of grace. We're gonna, that was the two gifts that God gave the Israelites, right? The first gift he gave them was the law, the Ten Commandments. The second thing God gave them was the land, which was the land that God promised them, a land flowing with milk and honey. A land, incidentally, that other people already lived. And so there's some, that's a bigger topic, not for today. But then we go into the covenant of grace, which is to say what Paul said is that the law can only convict. The law cannot save. So the law cannot, the law can only point where you have violated the law or where you have stepped away from the law. The law in and of itself is static. It cannot change. It cannot save you. And so in order for us to be saved, something else had to happen. And that's Jesus, and that's the covenant of grace. How do we earn grace? We don't. If we earned it, it wouldn't be grace. Grace is, and so much of what we talk about is so scary to folks. Because it's the idea that we want to have, in America, we want to be able to control our destiny, right? We want to have our hands on things. We want to say that if it's a wrong choice, it's still my wrong choice. And if it's a right choice, it's my right choice, right? And in America, we have this idea, you can be anything, and God just says, it's me. I've got you. It's grace. You can't earn it. You can only accept it. So, at any point, this is it's supposed to be interactive. So, at any point you can interrupt. The Old Testament, the Pentateuch, the Torah, the history of Israel, wisdom literature, and the prophets. Wisdom literature is that really great part that's in the middle. So Psalms and Proverbs, Ecclesiastes. You know, the prophets are weighty. They're major prophets and they're minor prophets. And we'll hear more from the prophets as we get closer to Christmas, because that's when they generally make their appearance. But wisdom literature is stuff like the book of Job. Anybody ever read the book of Job? Whew, right? So when I was in Joplin, the year after the tornado, it was really one of the coolest things I ever got to participate in. They had a troop that came from New York City. Everybody know Paul Giamatti, the actor? David Sutherland, the actor, two other guys you would know, they don't remember their names. They came to Joplin and did two free shows where they just read the gospel. They read the book of Job. And they talked about what it means to sit in ashes and to hear Job and Joplin and stuff. And sometimes it's just enough to have wisdom literature that tells us times are going to be hard for a while, that it's not going to immediately get better. Because the worst thing the church can do is pretend like just give you a slap on the back and tussle your hair and say it's okay, it's going to be fine. Sometimes the church at its best is when the church sits in the ashes with people. And the church sits with the brokenness. We don't pretend we're not, we're something we're not. When I was in Alabama listening to Georgia Public Radio, there was a StoryCorps thing on NPR. I don't know if you've ever heard anything from StoryCorps, but really lots of great stuff. And there's this woman who was talking about a friend of hers who whose lights had been turned off. She had not paid her light bill, what they call the electricity bill in the South. And And so her friend was calling her and saying, can you give me some money or loan me some money so I can pay my light bill? And the person telling the story shared that she had to tell her friend that she didn't have enough money for her own light bill, and it had been turned off. And so she said, but I'll come over and I'll sit with you in the dark. And sometimes the church is at its best when it says, I can't fix that problem, but I'll come over and I'll sit with you in the dark. And so, and that's where we find a lot of the wisdom literature. The New Testament, the 27 books, the four Gospels. Gospels just mean good news. The word gospel, though, is actually an interesting word. Does anybody know where the word, it's euangelism, I'm going to mispronounce it. It's the Greek word for gospel, the Latin word for gospel. It's, anybody know where that comes from? This was not original to the Bible. It was actually, when they announced the good news, is when Caesar or the armies came back in Rome into the city. And when they had the parade, it was a good news about a military victory in some far-off land. And so what the good news of Jesus Christ is standing in exact opposition to the military power of Rome. So to use charged words, like we hear words like gospel and good news, and we're like, oh, wow. But it is actually everything the Bible is. So that's why I love what I do. This is why I love the Bible. It is saying that is their good news. It's good news through violence or the fear of violence or war. Our good news is grace. Our good news is faith. Our good news is getting something without asking, about being loved beyond measure. So these two things, the Bible's always set itself up to be as somewhere distinct from the culture around it. The Acts of the Apostles. So when I was growing up, we learned the Bible, the books of the Bible in order. Anybody have to do that growing up? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Leviticus, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts. We call it the Acts of the Apostles, but really Acts of the Apostles, probably better said, the Acts of the Holy Spirit. Because really, this is like the Holy Spirit's, jam. It's where the Holy Spirit really comes in a new and exciting way. And so for younger people, I apologize for saying that that's the Holy Spirit's jam. I know that's not cool. But so the Acts of the Apostles is actually an interesting thing because it is part two. The Acts of the Apostles is the sequel to the Gospel of Luke, because the author of the Gospel of Luke also wrote the Acts of the Apostles. And so if you want to read two books like kind of back to back, read Luke and then go into Acts, and I'll explain it. The epistles and then Revelation. So a lot of the epistles are written by Paul. Some of them are not, those letters. Some of them, frankly, are said to be written by Paul, but they're probably written by one of Paul's followers. That's for another time. But the epistles are where you get like 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. These are letters to churches, are letters to people. I am flying, so any questions? What it means to be a Christian. Hear the phrase Christ follower. It's kind of it's a popular thing in a kind of greater religious culture where people will say, well, I'm not a Christian, I am a Christ follower. And the rise of that is interesting because what it really is saying is, I don't want all the negative baggage that comes with being identified as a Christian. I'll raise my hand right here and say, I don't want all the negative baggage when people say, oh, that's what it means to be a Christian. Oh, that must mean that you're intolerant. Or it must mean that you're judgmental. Or it must mean that you're petty. Or it must mean that you gossip. Because, that's the thing is, people get really worried about the church, and I'm not. I grew up going to, how many of you grew up with Blue Laws? Any of the confirmation students know what a Blue Law is? Oh, they were awesome. Nothing was open on Sunday. The good old days. I don't know if those are good or bad, but the Blue Laws were set up where basically it says everything in culture said if you want if you want anything, you have to funnel to church on a Sunday morning. You know, the only places that were open in Springfield growing up were Chinese restaurants. And so we didn't eat at home, we had Chinese restaurants, growing Chinese. I'm not worried about the church because cultural Christianity is really not, it can go away. It can go away. Because this idea, like, people get really worried right now. Politicians talk about, you know, the attack on Judeo-Christian values and that kind of stuff. And my thing is, like, God's big enough for all this. I mean, the church flourished the most under Roman occupation. The church has grown the most in China and Africa and places where it's been illegal. And there is a cost to this. And so whether or not we have a Santa Claus and someone says Merry Christmas, I don't care. I just don't. We're fighting the wrong battles. And so if that is enough to say, like, I'm not a Christian, I'm a Christ follower, then I'll be happy to say I'm a Christ follower. However, the Bible tells us that we will be known to be Christ followers, or known to be Christians, by our love. You know, Jesus was not a Christian. Jesus was the Christ. We're Christians. And that means we're supposed to emulate and model what Jesus does. So really, really all it does is the very first thing to do, the basis of the Christian faith is to first say, we're sinners. We cannot do it on our own. And we're talking about individual sin and also corporate sin. So individual sin. So we do a unison prayer and confession. Have any of you all ever prayed the unison prayer and confession and were like, I didn't do that this week? The first time I was introduced to it when I was in sixth grade, it was like, I didn't do any of this stuff. I'm good. And the fact is, it's corporate sin. Because sometimes when we look and say, who's to blame? And it's all of us together. You know, I'm not getting on a soapbox here, but, and not to tell you to go left or right, middle on how we vote and how we do policies, but budgets, whether they are a budget for U.S. government, for the state of Missouri, for Baldwin, or St. Louis, or St. Louis County, or a family budget, every budget is a moral document. Every budget is a moral document because it says this is what matters most to us. Okay? And so when we look at what matters most to us individually and collectively, we're saying that sometimes collectively we miss the mark. Okay? Again, it's this idea. And so we all need grace. Where do we get it and how do we get it? And this is where it comes back to Christ. It's simple. Romans 10:9. Simple but hard. Will somebody read that while I get a cup of coffee?
Sure.
Okay.
Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved.
Also get impressive. Yeah, tell me impressive. I know. You remember class every week. It's believing in your heart, confessing with your mouth, living it with your life. That's it. And we're told that without the Spirit's help, none of us can call it door to door. So the Spirit is always already working with us. Does anybody have any questions about this verse? How many of you have ever heard this phrase, it's not a religion, it's a relationship? It is very popular nowadays. It has been for about the last 15 years. Yes and no. So I love my wife, which is good. I could read a book about my wife. I'm assuming there's one written. I don't know. There should be. And I can learn where she went to high school. You know, I can learn her favorite foods. I can learn the things she really likes, favorite music, things she does not like. I can learn all these things about her, but if I never met her, it'd be different, right? It's that difference between sitting across the table from somebody and knowing about somebody. It is also to mention the word relationship is never mentioned in the Bible. It's just not there. And so sometimes the idea is like, I can have a relationship, but if you're not actually being in a room with other people helping you to have that relationship, which is called church, that room full of people, then we're gonna stumble. Because none of us are strong enough to do this walk by ourselves. And I think this is, I've talked to like siblings and relatives, and when they'll talk about, well, I don't need to go to church because I've got this relationship with God. It's kind of like, you know, I don't need to go to the movie theater because I've got Netflix. There's something different about going to a movie theater. There's something different about going to a football game or basketball game. There's something different about going to the ballet or the opera. There's something different about going to a church worship service. Because you are surrounded with other people. It is an experience. But how much different it is here where people, what I want St. Mark to be, in some ways it is, in some ways we can improve, is when someone says, how are you doing? They're asking me, how are you doing? You know, when I was in college, you know, yesterday I was walking around, I was wearing my hat. My head keeps getting bigger as I get older, I hate it. It's not, I'm not getting smarter, I'm just like macrocephalic. But this hat, it didn't feel right, so I put it on backwards. My wife's like, hey, my little frat boy. You know, and because we'd go walk around and be like, hey, what's up? What's up? This is the mid-90s. We were right at the cutting edge of what's up. And the idea, nobody ever said what's up. Just what's up, what's up. But you say, how are you? That's actually what I like, what I love about St. Mark is when we do that greeting time, it's the passing of the peace. We can talk later, hopefully in the narthex, over a cup of coffee or dinner or whatever. But to say, peace be with you. Just, that's enough. That's enough. So in the church, what we're focused on are two things, roots and branches. The roots, which are our history, really, really matter. And the branches, which are our present and our future. A lot of churches just focus on the roots. There's a church I attended that was in Basking Ridge, New Jersey. Anyone ever been to Basking Ridge? It's a beautiful little town, right? And so the Presbyterian Church is right at the end of the street. It looks like Norman Rockwell. There's two streets that kind of converge, and there's this beautiful old Presbyterian church there. They've got this old tree. And this tree is diseased now. The tree has either been taken down, but George Washington allegedly had lunch under this tree. Everything is about this oak tree. The name of their newsletter is called Oak Leaves. Everything's about this tree. Great! At some point, they're kind of becoming Shinto. Like, they worship this tree as much. That became like their golden calf. There's sometimes in churches, we're so concerned with our roots, like this is the way we used to do something. And we don't see something about today, right? What God's calling us to be. Now, the other problem is if it's all about branches. And so many new churches will start up and say, like, hey, we finally cracked the code. After 2,017 years, we finally have the one true church, and it just happens to be in St. Charles. You know, it's like, I mean, they both matter, right? And, like, this is the whole point. We pay attention to our history, but we're also growing. So it's rooted in love, but growing in grace. There's a lot. A quick trip through 2,000 years of Christian history. It's been said Jesus did not come to change the world. Jesus came to change 12 men. And because Jesus changed those 12 men, those 12 men went on to change the world. Now, yes and no. Right? The truth is somewhere in between, because think about this, the early church was small. We're talking in the hundreds at Pentecost. We're talking when people get together in the upper room, and when the Holy Spirit comes and people start speaking in tongues, it's called glossolalia. It was small. You look at when Jesus had risen from the dead, and people would say, like, read the Bible. Why do you believe the Bible to be true? There's two things. One is in the Old Testament, it tells us every flaw of every hero, right? It does not just make superheroes. It says, Abraham did this wrong, Moses did this wrong, David did this wrong. It's not covering up anybody's stuff. But in the New Testament, there's a story that when we look about Jesus on the cross. And so you had 12 disciples. One betrays him, Judas, right? Peter denies him. Nine others get scattered. There's only one who remains. Anybody remember the one who remains? John, the beloved disciple. And so they've lost. Their leader is dead. He's died on the cross. There's no reason to go on. And so the reason I believe in the resurrection is because something changed for these 11 men. Something changed. Judas hung himself. I don't think Judas was irredeemable. I think, Jesus went to Peter and reinstated him and brought him back in the fold, asking him three times if you love me. But something changed that had to, that all these men that fled and denied and scattered, all but John died a martyr's death. None of them are going to die for something that's, you're not going to die on a cross upside down like Peter did for something that didn't happen. You're not going to come back to something you already abandoned. Something had to change. But what happened, though, is at Pentecost, you have the growing of the church. And the fact that they're speaking in tongues, so have any of you all ever attended a church that there was glossolalia speaking in tongues? Or I have. Sometimes it is, I grew up with it, actually. Not the church I went to, but the denomination I was a part of. And sometimes it can be a cacophony, lots of different noises of people speaking in tongues all the way around you. The reason the New Testament, we talk about speaking in tongues, it is a response to the Tower of Babel. You know, the Tower of Babel in the Old Testament, where people try to build a tower to get to heaven, and then God throws them into confusion, and where they no longer speak the same languages. That's how they explain it. I mean, for me, I read that more as an allegory, but the Pentecost is a response to that. It's that now you can speak in languages you don't know, and you can understand. And so this idea that this is no longer just a religion for Jews. No longer just have to speak Hebrew or Aramaic. You can speak Hindi. You can speak Arabic. You can speak all the different languages. It was basically saying what the speaking in tongues was, is that we're going global with this. That's a pretty awesome thing that goes on. And so, I can talk more about speaking in tongues, but we're not necessarily that church. But the church goes all over, and so churches start getting planted all over the place. And different churches have different ideas on important matters. Right? Does everyone here get along all the time with their family?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. I was going to sip on my coffee for a little bit and see if anybody...
I hear an amen.
Amen, amen. But we don't get along because to be in relationship is to have friction. To be in real relationship, right? Like, we can all be put those veneers up, right? And we could all just, like, the fake me can talk to the fake you. You know, and that happens a lot. But, you know, church is a place to be real. And when we're real, we realize we're going to have real disagreements. And so the early church, there were a number of different pockets. So you had the church in Rome, and you had the church in Constantinople, in the East. You had all these different churches, and each one, I think there's seven, but they would come together to have seven ecumenical councils, and this was to figure out what books were in the Bible, what books were not. Like, you read the Da Vinci Code? It's a lot of fun. That's a lot of fun. And people are like, hey, we've broken something. It's like, I've been talking about it for 2,000 years, but I guess we broke it, you know? But the Da Vinci Code was trying to prove, like, there's this big conspiracy to keep the Gospel of Thomas out of the Bible. There was not a big conspiracy to keep the Gospel of Thomas out of the Bible. There were certain rules they said when they're going to have, when they prayed about this, sought the guidance of the Holy Spirit. They had to prove that this was written in the first century by an eyewitness of Jesus. This was not. There's so much stuff where people, we get like a sliver of truth and we're like, gee, I know. We don't. This is the point. But so that's how they determined what books were in the Bible, what books were not. It's also the bigger question of how we view Jesus. So the Nicene Creed, you know, is Jesus 50% human and 50% God? Was he 100% one and 100% the other? Well, the Nicene Creed says is we confess that Jesus was 100% God and 100% human. And people say, how can that be? And the answer is, I don't know. It is a mystery. But there's a fellow named St. Anselm. We've got a St. Anselm church around here somewhere, right? But St. Anselm, he had a book called Curdeus Homo, which is Why the God-Man. And what he argued basically says that human sin, can I get an amen? Well, thank you. We all sin, right? Yes, we do. So if you sin, you owe the penalty, right? Okay, right here. God is the one who can forgive the penalty, right? All right. So in order for the penalty to be forgiven, we have to have someone who can forgive it, which is God. And so if it is 50% God and 50% human, it would only forgive maybe 50% of our sins. So it's the idea of the whole God and the whole human, that Jesus was both. And this is what Scripture says. So, again, we're getting into the weeds a little bit here, but it's so important to see the early church was trying to figure this out. We're trying to faithfully figure this out. And so there are all kinds of controversies. This date might look familiar. I mean, this is celebrating 1517, 500 years since the beginning of the Protestant Reformation. But the first big one was in 1054, and that was called the Great Schism. Anybody know about the Great Schism? Well, it's between the Eastern Orthodox Church and the Roman Catholic Church. The Western Church was the Roman Catholic Church. They excommunicated each other. 500 years. So really excommunication just meant you're cut off from community. So it meant they did not recognize each other anymore. I mean, sometimes people say, well, where are we going? Why are we in this handbasket, right? You know, people think everything is falling apart. There's a lot of good stuff going on in the world. The Eastern Orthodox folks, the Greek Orthodox, the Russian Orthodox, they're talking with the Pope in Rome. The Lutherans are talking with the Catholics. There's a lot of good stuff that's going on right now. So the Great Schism in the Eastern Church and the Western Church, and if you ever go to an Eastern Orthodox church, it might feel a little Catholic, but it's very different. It's very different. In fact, it's awesome. There's so much good stuff if you go to a Greek Orthodox church. A lot of smells and bells. So, I mean, the Catholics do okay with incense, the Greek Orthodox. I mean, there you go to the Coptic church, they start swinging that stuff around, and it's fantastic. And I could do a whole semester on the Eastern Orthodox Church. They also have cool beards. Reformation fever speeds. Spreads through Europe, Germany, England, France, Switzerland, Scotland. Eventually, it makes its way to America. So Germany is where it starts. And so we're going to sing, we've already sung it twice with the two previous services. By the end of the 10:30 service, we're going to sing, remember that song? So when I was a kid, we got to see that all the time because there was a cartoon that was on. Everybody remember the cartoon that had that song? It wasn't a cartoon, it was Claymation. Sunday morning Claymation, about a boy and his dog. Davy and Goliath. Everybody remember Davy and Goliath? I've got a Goliath bobblehead in my office. Come by, it's fun. But, because Davey would come to like situations, there'd be like, and he's like, is he gonna make a good choice? Or is he gonna make a bad choice? And then the dog would talk to him. It's like Son of Sam, right? Now that we look at it, but the dog would talk to him and say, I don't think we're supposed to do that. And do you remember it? It's the book. Well, that's it. Thanks, Robin. But David and Goliath was actually sponsored by the Evangelical Lutheran Church of America, by the Lutherans. But it always ended with these claymation horns, or these, they play the tune for Mighty Fortress is Our God. So in Germany, when the Protestant Reformation happened, basically, when we think of Germany, think of it not as a unified country, think of it as castles. If you ever go to Germany, you'll see castles. And there's like a certain area that prince had control over. So if a prince remained Catholic, that area was Catholic. Whatever your prince was, you were. If the prince became Lutheran, then that area was Lutheran. And so literally when Martin Luther is singing or writing a song in the words, a mighty fortress is our God, he is saying a mighty fortress is our God. This is not symbolic. He's saying that in order for the Reformation of Lutheran Church to remain, it needs to have a wall around it to be protected. Now, one of the reasons the Protestant Reformation started is because Luther today would probably be in therapy. He had a lot of anxiety. Anybody ever been a Lutheran? Hey, for Lutherans. Luther would go in and talk to his confessor when he was Roman Catholic, when he was a priest. He'd go, and when Luther got married, you know who he married? A nun. True story. But Luther would go and talk to his confessor, and he'd be in there for 2 or 3 hours. You can imagine the confessor like, you know, help me, Jesus. You know, it's like, Luther goes in and about the minutia, because he was so racked with guilt and anxiety about hell. And then he would leave the confessional. He would walk out, he would see another priest he didn't like, have a bad thought, go back in, start the process over. And what Luther realized is that he did not need an intercessor between himself and God. Go back to the scripture and says, you don't need to confess it to somebody. However, it's funny sometimes, if we're over in an accountability group or talking to people that we're real with, there's some stuff that will keep us more on a holy path if somebody else will hold us accountable. And say, I know you're struggling with gossip. I know you're struggling with this or that. So because sometimes with God, we're like, well, God will forgive us. We can tell God these things, but we're afraid to tell our friends. You know, and so that sometimes will help us. So there's something about confession when you have direct access to God. So from Germany, you have the Lutherans. From England, you have the, you guys got this. What church was in England? The Church of England, yes, the Anglican Church. And so that got started mainly because Henry VIII wanted a divorce. True story. I mean, the theology's better, but the genesis of this is that the Pope would not annul his marriage. So you have the start of the Church of England. Now, France, we don't really think of France as a very Protestant country, and there's a reason for that. It's called the St. Valentine's Day Massacre. It's because all the Protestants in France got the heck out. Because these people were, the French Protestants were called, anybody know? Huguenots. I feel like here's Miller's Day Off. Anyone? Anyone? Huguenots. Something not. So, but from France came John Calvin. And John Calvin was a French lawyer. He leaves France, goes, ends up eventually in Geneva. And in Geneva is a city on a hill. Place. And at Geneva, he writes, it basically becomes a theocracy. Are we in the time?
It's about 10:20. Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry, you're in your glory.
I'll just finish. So he's there. People start coming to him. John Knox comes to him from Scotland. The Church of Scotland comes from that. You have the Dutch Reformed that come down. And this is the beginning of what's known as Reformed churches. And we're going to talk about that next week and how it makes its way to America. I would ask you all if you have any questions, but if you do, talk to me after the. All right. Thank you all.
Thank you.
I'll go ahead.